Okay. So, yeah, that introduction, I mean, I can't vouch for its validity, and I would take issue. I think there's a bit of exaggeration and so on. But there is one thing that's clear, and that's that you know nothing about me, which is fine, except that there is one key fact I think you have to understand for the context of this presentation. I'm a doctor, okay? But I'm not like that guy who works in a cushy office. I work in a place like this, a busy emergency department in Toronto. And yet, despite what it says, this is not the way it is. We don't have a lot of fancy, you know, romances going on and cases that would stump William Osler. No, the reality of emergency departments in Canada and most of the rest of the world looks a bit more like this. So, very crowded, lots of patients who come with complex medical and social problems that stump us, but not really for medical reasons, but just because we don't know what the hell to do with these patients. And you have a lot of providers, doctors and nurses running around doing the best they can under difficult circumstances to provide good care. So let me tell you about a story that happened to me. I was working a shift one day in the emergency department when an elderly woman, we'll call her Mrs. Jones, came in to see me. She had a cough and a fever. Now, this was one of those days that I mentioned, one of those shifts that were so busy. And so, you know, I thought I did a pretty good job. I diagnosed her pneumonia, I prescribed some antibiotics, and I sent her home. I thought, you know, I'd provided pretty good care to her, until I got the phone call. This is me getting the phone call. It was a pharmacist, and the pharmacist said, "Did you prescribe that clarithromycin?" And I said, "Yes." "Did you know that the patient was on Coumadin?" And I said, "Yes." "Did you know that there's an adverse reaction between clarithromycin and Coumadin?" And I said, "Yes." And that got me thinking. I did know the patient was on warfarin. And I did know, of course, I'd prescribed the clarithromycin. And I even knew about the drug interaction. It's a very common one. But at that time, my synapses had not connected to prevent that potential risk to the patient. I just had totally forgot about the drug interaction. And it got a whole bunch of us wondering. It was really our aha moment. It was wondering, how is it that under certain conditions, when it's crowded versus when it's not so crowded, what we do changes. The decisions we make, the way our brains actually work, changes and can expose people to risk as a result. And the more we thought about this, the more we realized, hey, there's a study in here. We could actually study this and determine whether this is true. But to do this, you're going to need data. A lot of data. Why? Because the kind of adverse reactions we can identify, like deaths and hospitalizations, in admin data, well, they're pretty rare to result from these sorts of adverse events. So you're going to need data not on 100 patients, not on thousands of patients. You're going to need data on millions of patient encounters. And not only do you need it for a lot of patients, but for each patient, you're going to need to know about the ER visits the patient had, their hospitalizations, the drugs that they might be on, their encounters with physicians in the community, census data to know about things like socioeconomic status, and outcomes. Did they live or did they die? And once you've got all that data, you need to bring it all together. You need to bring it all together and link it anonymously, as we all know, and do that in such a way that you can follow patients over time and throughout the healthcare system. And not only that, you need to do that while respecting all of the security and privacy provisions that make sure we don't get let out in handcuffs by the IPC when we do these sorts of studies. Now you got your data set, and then you need the powerful computers at ISIS. This is one we just had installed a few weeks ago. And that is one of our statisticians who's adjusting the algorithms to account for the biases and the confounders that are so prevalent in observational research. But this is what we know how to do at ISIS. And when you do it, this is what comes out. A nice, clear figure that shows that when Mrs. Jones goes into an emergency department that happens to be busy, she is at higher risk of being dead 7 days later than if the same patient went into the same emergency department at a time that wasn't so busy. Did you hear that? Yes, that's what we just said, that these patients are at higher risk of death. So if she goes into my emergency department on a shift that's really crowded, within 7 days, she's more likely to be admitted to hospital or to be dead as compared to if she'd gone into a shift in my hospital when it wasn't so crowded. Now, these results, this study, came out at a time when there was all sorts of controversy, all sorts of attention to this problem, not just in Canada, but in the UK, in Australia, in the US, around ED crowding, around long wait times, around whether we should have targets for wait times or not, the four-hour rule in the UK, the four-hour rule in Australia now as well. And this was one of the first studies to bring important data to bear on an important public policy question. And God be praised, we got it published in a high-impact journal. And this is fantastic for all of us academics. I mean, our citations go up, our H index goes up, our I-10 index goes up, and that is all really, really fantastic. But we all know that what we really want is not any of this stuff. What we want is this stuff, right? We want to be seen in the press. I mean, we're no different from Lindsay Lohan or Paris Hilton. I mean, we want to be in the press. And what could be better than Ben Goldacre writing about your paper in his Bad Science column in The Guardian? Now, normally, I don't want my research being talked about as bad science, but, you know, when it's Ben Goldacre, you'll take what you can get, right? So let's see what Ben Goldacre had to say about this paper. He wrote the following. We all know one atom of experience isn't enough to spot a pattern. But when you put lots of experiences together and process that data, you get new knowledge. This might sound obvious, but following it through, watching patterns emerge from the noise, still gives me a sense of beauty and awe. Watching patterns emerge from the noise still gives me a sense of beauty and awe. And that's what it's about, isn't it? Looking at this administrative data in a different way, putting a particular set of lenses so it looks very different, and suddenly patterns emerge, answers emerge that we wouldn't see if we didn't look at it in that way. But okay, before we pat ourselves on the back too hard, let's keep reading through his column and get to the online comments where the truth really lies. Here's an online comment written by Boogie Wonderland who said, "It's crap research like this that leads to ridiculous strategies such as the four-hour wait limit in the UK." Okay. So who's right? Is it Boogie Wonderland or is it Ben Goldacre? I don't know. I leave that to you to decide. But I will point out this one thing. The one thing you know about me is that I am sensitive and I cry easily. So if you're going to ask me questions about this, be gentle. Thank you.